In the not-so-distant future, RAN is going to kick it up a notch with the release and transition from DDR4 to DDR5. But Roby, what's the difference? Do I need to make the switch on day one? Isn't RAM already wicked fast? Well, let's talk about that right here, right now on Roby Tech. So we're all pretty aware of what RAM is currently capable with DDR4. While it's only in a few extreme cases, DDR4 has been able to hit speeds of up to 5,000 megahertz, and that is stupid fast. Capacity per DIMM was 32 gigabytes, meaning you could hit a max of 256 gigabytes total if your motherboard supported up to 8 slots. And I know what you're thinking, why would I need RAM to go faster than that? And the answer is, the future. See, the thing is, as hardware starts to get more and more powerful, it gets hungrier and hungrier for more and more bandwidth. Take a look at like AMD's flagship Ryzen CPU, the 5950X, with its 16 cores and 32 threads with its memory speed specification of 3200 megahertz. See, that's a lot, and it's been growing faster and faster as time has gone on. And we can only guess what Alder Lake and Ryzen 6000 is going to do as it gets further and further along. So as we look towards the future, and specifically the rumors surrounding the Alder Lake CPUs from Intel, which we'll cover in another video soon, faster RAM will be standard, with Intel detailing a supported 4800 megahertz for its upcoming 12th generation CPU lineup that will leverage DDR5 memory. 4800 megahertz. That's bonkers. And remember, DDR4 was capped at 5,000, sort of, and we're kicking things off with 4,800 megahertz. Now, one of the benefits of moving up to DDR5 is that the maximum capacity per DIMM is going up, like way up. See, take what you think that might be and make it more, because DDR5 will see capacities hitting 128 gigabytes per DIMM. Now, let's not be too hasty. It's not like we are going to see day one 128 gigabyte sticks of RAM. That's still a ways out. But there's a lot of cool things we can think about as we approach next gen, specifically with small form factor motherboards usually having fewer RAM slots. Maybe they'll be packing a bigger punch with these smaller builds in the future, given you could actually run 256 gigs if you wanted to. How awesome would that be? Like a portable, super small form factor like editing rig. And remember that we mentioned that Intel had detailed 4800 megahertz support for its 12th gen CPU? But DDR5 will be able to hit speeds in excess of 6400 megahertz. The speed, that's crazy. So far we know that the manufacturers like Corsair, Kingston, TeamForce, Samsung, and SK Hynix all have DDR5 slated for the launch of Alder Lake. Now, one of the other major changes with DDR5 is the voltage regulation has moved off of the motherboard and onto the chip. This means it's going to be up to the manufacturer of the RAM to control the balance of performance and power, as well as solve for one of the biggest issues moving forward with this next generation of hardware, heat. See, we saw what happened with NVMe drive when they moved from PCIe Gen 3 to PCIe Gen 4. Many of those drives required a heat sink, and in some cases, quite a beefy heat sink indeed. In fact, Seagate developed a whole heat sink in conjunction with EK to cool their Seagate FireCuda 530s. Now take the Corsair Dominator series of RAM. Since the beginning, the Dominator lineup has had an intense heatsink solution. They are kicking things up a notch going into DDR5, knowing that there is undoubtedly going to be more heat generated from the RAM alone. So this raises a few questions when it comes to design and picking your PC parts. Now that many manufacturers will see triple C thick heat sinks on their RAM, CPU coolers, radiators, motherboards, and cases will have to take that into account when determining clearance. Hello NZXT, hello Z series of AIOs, we're talking about you. And with so much heat being generated by all those components, is air cooling your CPU even gonna be an option in the world of 12th gen and DDR5? Now, aside from the heat, there's the question of what programs and games will support RAM in higher quantities and faster speeds. For some games, more than 128 gigabytes of RAM can actually already cause stability issues. Now what happens when you have that much on just a single stick? So all of this bears the question, who is DDR5 for anyways? Well, if you're using a PC for gaming, it's probably actually not for you, since the largest impact on gaming performance is your CPU, GPU, and the drive the game is running on. Super wicked fast RAM in large quantities like 256 gigabytes won't get you more FPS like upgrading the main components on your system. But what DDR5 is definitely good for is processes that require faster reading and writing of temporary files. This means Photoshop artists dealing with large files, editors and VFX artists working in 6 6K or 8K. 3D programs, if you're working with a lot of high resolution textures and other similar power users, would definitely see a huge bump in system performance by jumping up in speed and capacity when DDR5 drops. If you're live streaming, then yes, you could see a benefit of getting faster RAM, making it easier on your system when you're live and running multiple programs in the background or plugins that would make use of higher speeds in DDR5. That being said, there isn't much of a reason for upgrading to higher capacity RAM unless you are also going to be doing some of those previously mentioned tasks like high resolution video editing and animation. Another thing to keep in mind is that if you're considering upgrading, is that for now, you'll have to use an Intel CPU and accept that there'll be growing pains with the transition from DDR4 to DDR5. There are going to be struggles, you will have issues, more than likely if you're going to be an early adopter. Waiting for companies like Adobe to sort themselves out while supporting the newer and faster RAM, motherboards are probably going to see some significant BIOS updates shortly after they launch, but the early next-gen CPUs will more than likely support both, so you may not even need to make the DDR5 jump if you want a new CPU. So it might be a better call to hold off on the switch unless you're looking to build a new PC at the same time next-gen CPUs launch. And speaking of next-gen CPUs, we don't even have an official word on when we can expect next-gen Ryzen CPUs outside of sometime in 2022. And it's not even for sure if it will support DDR5. So one thing you can count on though, is that as soon as it's available, you'll see us building with it and testing it right here on Robitech. So you better subscribe right now so you don't miss that. So that's it for this video. What did you think? Do you think that you'll make the jump from DDR4 to DDR5 later this year? How beefy do you think these heat sinks are going to be? And have you seen some of them already? What do you need 256 gigs of 8600 megahertz DDR5 RAM for? And what's your favorite Dance Dance Revolution game? See what I did there? It's DDR5. Now let us know in the comments below. Now while you're down there, make sure you slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so you get a notification each and every time we either post a video or go live right here on Robitech. Also, join our amazing community over at Discord, discord.gg/Robitech. If you have questions about PCs or you want to talk about tech or building, all of that stuff's happening over there in our amazing community. Also, make sure you check out robitechdeals.com if you want the latest deals on tech. We try to find you the cheapest and best prices for all of your PC components and gaming needs. And finally, check out robitechstore.com if you want to check out some of our super amazing and very fashionable Robitech merch. Anyway, guys, if you want to see more on this, check us out on all the socials, and we look forward to seeing you on the next video.